the Anti-Money Laundering Act. Still, Senator Serge Osmeña remains optimistic Congress will be able to come out with the amendments expanding the predicate crimes, including tax evasion, under the AMLA by early next year. The AMLA amendments is just one of several topics we're taking up today. So joining us here on Mornings, Senator Serge Osmeña. Senator, thank you so
Good
much
morning, Pinky.
For coming over. Let's start with the political dynasties. How would you define a political dynasty?
It all depends how you want, how the majority of the population want to define it. Usually it's defined as any two or more members of the same family holding political positions. Of course, that's not antipathetic to people themselves. I mean, I've seen in the United States where Ted Kennedy was senator from Massachusetts and Bobby Kennedy was senator from New York, and they called that the Kennedy dynasty. However, there was no relationship in the sense that Ted couldn't make Bobby win in New York and okay. Bobby couldn't make Ted win in Massachusetts. They
right.
won on their own merits.
Yeah. But, you know, back I was reading some research material, Senator. Back in 1995, I think Senator Orly Mercado was trying to pass an anti-dynasty bill, political dynasty bill, and he was told when he talked to his counterpart in the House at that time, his counterpart at the House said, "Don't bother. It's not going to pass through the House." So you were saying, I don't want to bother with this up until you guys pass an anti-political dynasty bill first.
That's correct. As a matter of fact, I was the one who narrated that story about Orly Mercado to the reporters last week.
Mm-hmm.
But I just found out yesterday when former Senator and former Vice President Tito Gingona visited the Senate also to attend the hearing on political dynasties that he also did the same thing in 1987. Or 1988, it passed the Senate, and the House said, "Don't bother sending that bill to us. We're not going to pass it."
So, what do you think? Is there a number one, are you against it?
I'm in favor of it. That was one of the first bills
okay.
I worked on when I was elected to the Senate in 1995. So, I think within 3 months, we already had an anti-political dynasty bill, and I think we were going to get about 16, 18 votes.
Okay.
And then the House said, "Wag mo ipadala dito yan, di papasaya."
So you're for it. You tried it in 1995. You think there's a chance, or should we just stick to a public
term? It will always pass the Senate.
Yes. It will.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, whether it passes the House is another matter.
Okay. But how do you feel, though, Senator? Let's talk about local politics. Because I understand, sir, the anti-political dynasty bill, authored by Senator Miriam Defensora Santiago, does not include the Senate. Diba? I mean, it does not include the provisions of a dynasty.
Does not
include national positions.
Let me put it this way. If you are in a position to substantially control or substantially influence the outcome of elections, that was what we were going to prohibit. But kung walang connection, if I were governor of Cebu, at my brother wanted to run for governor of Davao. Ano pa kaya po sa Davao?
That's fine.
I don't have a single... that would not be a prohibited dynasty. Now, for the Senate, I'm a senator and a relative is running for a lower office. That's not dynasty. But I'm president and a relative is running for the Senate. That would be considered
I see. Prohibited
that's when, dynasty.
That's why you were saying element of power.
Yes.
That should be understood, but then eventually, let's just say for the sake of argument, something like that is passed. That element of power or influence, as you are calling it, will be a gray area for so many people and a cause of, you know, questions before the Supreme Court, probably.
Yes. No, right now, no, because there's no anti-dynasty law.
Yes, sir. I mean, in the event that it is passed. Can you imagine that? I mean,
it depends what is passed.
which can be passed, or if it will be passed at all. So mahaba pa yan, Senator.
Mahaba pa yan. As a matter of fact, the problem of the House or in the House would be governor, mayor. I'm governor of Cebu,
right.
And my son runs for mayor of one of the towns or one of the cities.
And a councilor.
Or else. I'm retiring as governor, and my wife right. runs to succeed me. Ayon,
magkakaroon ng problema. That leaves a bad taste in the mouth of a lot of people. But again, I guess as you said, let's wait for the House if they pass it. If not, it won't be passed. It can be passed in the Senate, but we have a problem at the House of Representatives. Okay, let's talk about the Financial Action Task Force, Senator. A lot of things we need to discuss with you. Just to give a brief background, and please correct me if I'm wrong, sir. We're on the gray list area right now. We almost was downgraded from dark gray to gray again because we failed to pass the third measure that the FATF was asking us to pass, the Philippines. Correct, sir?
We were downgraded from gray to dark gray earlier this year, about January, because we did not pass the two measures. But we did in May. So what was hanging was the third measure. But because we did in May, they gave us an upgrade from dark gray to gray.
Right, yeah.
When we did not pass
the third one,
there was a threat that we would be downgraded to blacklist already. However, our team was able to convince the Financial Action Task Force, I think they met in Paris, that we had just run out of time.
Okay.
And so to give us 3 or 4 months leeway, and that by the end of January we should have passed the law.
So I guess that's the time frame they're looking at. Contentious issues, sir. How I understand it is that you need to add 9 predicate crimes and 20 plus activities.
23
to the Anti-Money Laundering Act. The most contentious would be in the predicate crimes would be tax evasion, right?
That's always been the most contentious. When I filed one of my bills in 2001, tax evasion was there, pinatanggal. 2003, pinatanggal. So that's always going to be removed. I expect it will be removed.
Even when you continue hearings on this, you feel that matatanggal tax evasion?
Yes, because the recommendations of the Financial Action Task Force, the 9 covered institutions and the 23 predicate crimes are recommendations.
Okay.
All right. However, it's almost like automatic if we do not subscribe to it, because the Financial Action Task Force is the group. It's a group of 31 nations. We are a member only by virtue of our being part of the Asia-Pacific group. And while they cannot impose sanctions, all they can do is, it's like a rating, like the Standard and Poor or the Fitch ratings, when they say failing grade yan.
Right.
Then we start getting restrictions imposed by other jurisdictions. Okay. So, for example, I'll give you an example. When the United States started pressuring the Swiss government and the Swiss Central Bank to deliver the list of Americans who were salting their dollars away in Switzerland in order to avoid U.S. taxes, Switzerland said, no, we're not going to cooperate. We're a separate country. And then Americans said, that's fine. And the American banks, with whom the Swiss banks do a great deal amount of business, said, all right, we're not going to be too cooperative.
Uh-huh.
And the Swiss just collapsed. The Swiss collapsed, that their branches, the branches of the Swiss banks in America were fined $780 million. And they paid.
Yeah. So there are repercussions.
Malalaki sila. We have to do business with the US, with Japan, with Europe, etc. So if they say, teka muna pinky, don't send any money, we cannot transmit any money this month to your relatives because
binabantayan kami ngayon eh.
My gosh, that's really going to hurt our economy.
So what would be the outcome, Senator, if they wanted an additional 9 predicate crimes? And for example, as you were saying, tax evasion might not make it. Would that be a problem for the FATF?
I think we can argue our way and play for time out of that one, because one aspect is they describe the crime as a violation of the Internal Revenue Code of a specific country. And tax evasion is only one violation.
That's
so
true, yeah.
So we can include a phrase that says violation of the Internal Revenue Code except section XXX.
So you're just disguising it, really.
Well, you know, these are games people play.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not in favor of it. I've been pushing the thing since 2001, but wala tayong magagawa. So we're going to try to come as close to what the FAT recommends, the FATF recommends.
But you do understand, or do you accept the reasoning of some of your colleagues that this can be used for political persecution?
Yes, yes, yes. There is always that fear and that danger. You're right.
Okay.
So come election time, they can use that against you. I mean, if they're in power, then
yes.
They're sitting in Malacanang at medyo galit kay Pinky Web. they will raise that.
Okay.
Even if it's not true, tapos yes. na yung campaign. Tinamaan ka na.
Oh. Yeah. Okay. So you're a little bit open to that. Let's talk. This one, I think you're quite sure of or certain, or you really want this in. The real estate properties that are bought. My understanding, sir, is that if you buy a real estate property and make a down payment of $10,000, roughly 400,000 pesos, more
yeah.
or less.
410,000 now.
410,000. You want that included in the list of activities,
that's
included
right.
in the 23 list of activities.
Uh-huh.
Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile doesn't want this done. He argues, sir. Anyway, you can go to the BIR and check the income of Pinky and see if I can actually afford to buy this piece of property. So why include it in the activities?
That's begging the question. The reason why... like banks, for example, for the last 40, 50 years in the United States, that $10,000 reporting limit was already in place, you know?
That's
so
true.
So I went to a bank, say if I went to the Wells Fargo branch
yeah.
in California, and I had cash deposit of $11,000, they would report that. I did not violate the law. They just reported at iniipon yung... Yung, wow, I mean, they had huge computers. They do have huge computer system. And later, the computer will be able to figure out if there's a pattern that Serio deposits large amounts without having any financial justification for it. Wala naman silang income. Wala naman siyang, so they will just invite me and say, may we know where this money is coming from? Because I will not have violated any law at that point. So these are just warning signals
yeah.
that
Red
the
flags.
Financial community yeah. wants in order to be sure that they would be able to cover the loopholes that now exist in the anti-money laundering law.
So
that's a very big loophole, by the way.
So I understand, sir, tax evasion, but properties... I'm kind of open to it because I don't understand why not.
Okay, let me explain to you. I have X amount. Let's say I make 10 million pesos a month in drug dealing. All right. Gusto ko tanguin yan, no? I mean, I can't go around and buy a big mansion and live in it because people say, teka muna, where
San
did you get
yung
that?
Pera yeah. niyan.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to try to launder it so it comes back to me legally. So I can ask a friend to sell me his company for 10 million pesos when actually the company is only worth 2 million, right?
Pero
na launder ko na.
Correct.
So
yeah.
Now after 1 year, legal na yon, then I will now sell it
yeah.
and I take my cash out. Real estate is one of the biggest ways to launder money. Because I have 10 million, so I'll go to Cagayan de Oro
mm-hmm.
and I'll buy a piece of real estate. Never mind the $10,000, that's nothing.
Mm.
I mean, you know, we're looking for the 10, 20 million transactions
yeah.
and taking and seeing how they match a whole, no? So in Cagayan de Oro, I'll buy 10 million, and then next month in Zamboanga, I'll buy another 10 million. You need. Good computers to keep track of this, but you do want that reported, and maybe it will take 2, 3, 4, 5 years, but a pattern will come
Agal
up
din, no, sir?
Yes.
Two, three,
yes.
four, five
no,
years.
It, it's not an overnight thing.
No, actually, what I was telling you, sir, was that I understood the problem of tax evasion being part of a predicate crime. I understand that completely. What I don't understand is the opposition to real estate being part of the activities that could be observed under, because obviously, sir, I mean, una-una, it's got to be in your, you know, somehow your statement of assets, liabilities, and net worth if you're a government official.
Only if you're a government official, but we're not trying to catch government officials per se. We're trying to catch money launderers.
Sir, that's what I'm saying. SAL, SAL N for government officials. See, this does not include you guys being government officials. That's why I was saying I don't get why there is some opposition to buying real estate property being listed as part of the activities for AMLA.
Oh, I see. You don't know why politicians are objecting to it because
yes,
they already have.
That's what I'm asking you.
Why
sir?
Don't you ask them?
You know, because I don't know. I'm trying to understand why, but I don't seem to get it. But you think that will still be a problem? You think that will also be removed?
I hope. No, I hope to be able to explain it to them. We'll get some information or more information from the Financial Action Task Force. Mm-hmm. You know, the FATF says, here's the whole caboodle. Kayo, may butas dito, 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 dito. Pwede ba?
Papalan nyo na yung butas. Oh. Well, that also includes, sir, casinos.
That's right.
Earnings from casinos. Because that you can also pretend to have some winnings in casinos, right? And use that as...
Very easily. I will go to the casino and I'll give them... say $1,000,000. Okay, give me $1,000,000 worth of chips, and I'll leave the casino with $10,000,000 worth of chips. Legal na yun.
Mm-mm, mm-mm. Winnings mo yun sa casino.
Yeah, I will declare it as winnings.
Exactly. Okay, so that's another one that needs to be looked at. Yeah. And you also said, sir, people engaged in gold, silver, precious.
Yes,
metals.
Also, yeah, jewelry.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean. See, there's a lot of subjectivity, so I can always say, I bought this diamond from Pinky for $1,000,000, but some fool bought it from me for $10,000,000. Anong kagawa ko?
Diba? Hanap ka lang ng ibang tao that will say, yes, I bought it for $10,000,000. All right, but you are confident, Senator, that by January, this will make it?
I'm not that confident. In other words, I'd give it a confidence factor of about 75%.
Okay.
That's just a lot. That's 9 plus 23. So, you know, we're going to see what the body is willing to approve.
All right. Let's move on from the FATF. Let's talk about the Bridges to Nowhere program that you actually call it. That's 111 billion pesos, sir, that you had uncovered. There have been hearings at the Senate already.
Yes, yeah.
Where are you in terms of the hearings, sir? I understand you wanted to invite the president, but the former president, rather. But that seems to be impossible.
Yeah. We're about to conduct our third hearing next week. We think that we've pretty well nailed down the system that they set up. It's very good. They almost got away with it. There was another three contracts that were signed 2 months ago under the Aquino administration. Kasi akala nila, okay naman ito because we have done it 15 times in the past. Well, they did it an additional 3 times. And I had to request Malacanang, suspend those contracts. Or I'm going to, nail you to the wall on that.
I'm sorry, sir. The three ones are the recent ones in Palawan?
No. This is a Wagner Biro contract with Austria. This is an extension of the Centurion Construction Company of Spain contract. They turned it into a turnkey contract. From a supply contract, and the third one was a Cleveland Bridges contract of the UK. They were not ODAs. See? Bakit walang bidding? Anong ko kasi ako sa season? Teka
muna,
this is the same as ODA ba yan? Bakit walang bidding?
You're
so,
sure?
So, pinasuspend niya.
Okay, so in the other contracts prior to these three, sir, definitely it was not ODA.
It was definitely not official development assistance in the sense that it was a government-to-government transaction. Mm-hmm. Our ODA requires, one of the conditions is that it must be government-to-government.
Okay.
And then there's the financial end, that there must be a deep discount. of at least maybe 25% grant element, and then it must be for developmental purposes. I mean, you know, it can't be to build a
building.
A first class building on Makati Avenue.
No.
Yeah. So that element was not met. The government, and this was admitted by the very embassy that had previously tried to claim that it was official development assistance. As a matter of fact, in the UK, our biggest supplier, maybe Johnson, pleaded guilty to foreign bribery, and their chief executive officer went to jail.
Mm-hmm. And this is the same issue here, sir. It's maybe and Johnson too.
Yes. Maybe and Johnson and Eiffel Matier of France.
I see.
Between the two, they cornered 86 billion pesos.
Out of the 111?
Yes.
86. So roughly that's about 75%, sir. 70% of the contract. Where is it in terms of the Senate hearing, sir? I understand that you wanted to show us some contracts and pinpoint the people behind this. Where are you in terms of that?
We've pinpointed the people because the signatures are there. Right? And we've even gone further. We've gone to the undersecretary level because we have copies of the minutes of the approval of the approving agencies like DPWH, NEDA, Department of Finance.
Yeah.
So we have that already. What I'm trying to do now is run the numbers just to prove that they denominated the loans in yen. Kasi yen, parating 1-2% ang interest. So sabi nila, tinan mo, ang baba nito. That's not true because the reason why people don't borrow yen full term because it keeps on appreciating that you end up really paying more. than less.
That's right.
So
pero in
we've
paper,
been running the
it
number.
Looks like mababa yung interest
in the beginning,
yeah,
2%. But when you find out that it appreciated after 5 years by 50%, instead of having paid 100 million, you're now paying 150 million because, wow, laki
na lugi. So they've been getting away with that too for quite a long time.
Yes. That's right.
So, if you have the signatures, sir, I understand that some of the people that you wanted to call also were Secretaries Datu Manong.
Yes.
And Secretary Ebdane.
Ebdane. And Secretary Pangandaman. No, they have not turned up. They are members of the House. Or the Secretary Ebdane did write me, former Secretary, who is he's now Governor of Zambales.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that he was out of the country, but he would attend the next hearing.
But he was the DPWH Secretary for quite some time, sir.
That's right.
I mean, he was being moved from one post to another, and his last was DPWH.
No, he stayed a pretty long time. He went straight to DPWH upon his retirement from the military. I remember because I was sitting on the Commission on Appointments and we confirmed his appointment. The one that was always being moved around was former Secretary Angie Reyes.
Yes, sir.
He went from...
Yeah, everywhere.
Defense to the ILG, to the NR, to
that's
energy.
Correct. That's right, sir. But their liability would be what, sir? I mean, looking at this was approved by the NEDA. This has obviously had to be approved by the president, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, being the chairperson of the NEDA as well.
That's right.
How difficult, I guess, my question is, would it be to prove culpability among these people, except for the fact that they approved it?
Except for the fact that they approved it? If you're the approving... authority and your signatures on it, you're the person most culpable.
Is that it, sir? I mean, let me rephrase my question. Is there anything else that will point to them being liable aside from, you know, their signatures? Of course, that's damning evidence. Mm-hmm. That could be damning evidence. But is there something else? Is there a witness? Anybody that could actually point to any one of them?
The minutes of the meeting are quite deadly. Mm. The way they sidestep conditions that were established earlier na okay, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Pagkatapos, in the next meeting, nakalimutan yung 5.
Yung
basta
bat?
Approved na. Yun.
Naiwan si okay na wala si bat.
So, what happens is we can easily prove that the law on anti-graft was violated.
That's one.
And there are 2 points on the anti-graft law. One, you gave undue advantage. So the mere fact that hindi sila nag-conduct ng public bidding, and you advantage na yun.
Right.
Okay.
Number two.
Grossly disadvantageous contract to the government.
I see. Okay.
So we can prove that on the financial side, we can prove that on the bidding side, we can prove that on the delivery of the supply side.
How much longer do you think your hearing will take, sir?
The only problem we have is, you know, earlier this year, we wasted 6 months in the corona trial. No? We agreed, no investigation hearings. Now we have the syntaxes and the budget. How much longer? I only need about 2 to 3 hearings more, and I can finish that easily before we adjourn in December.
Okay, last topic, sir. Syntax bill, you know, there was a controversy in the beginning. What they called, some criticized the Recto bill as watered down. Sumama ang loob ni Senator Recto, he resigned. Pumalis si Senator Drilon. At one point, they actually wanted to use the Recto report, but then, of course, very recently, Senator Drilon gave his own version. 40 billion pesos, if I'm not mistaken, sir. Was it 40?
40.
Yes. 30 sa House, 40 kay Senator Drilon. Senator Recto was 15 to 20 billion. Are you happy with that? Does that seem like an accurate number? Because, I kind of tried to read...
Accurate in terms of what?
Tax collection that you can actually... that the Philippine government can actually collect 40 billion pesos annually.
No, we can collect that. What I'm looking at now, when I'm running the numbers today, tomorrow, Sunday, Monday, would be how much jobs would be lost, okay, if any, at what tax rate. So I'm doing the Laffer curve on it also to determine what is the optimum tax revenues government can expect at certain rates of taxation.
Okay,
there is that shaped like a bell. I call it a bell curve, but it's called the Laffer curve after Professor Arthur Laffer. Now, so we want to find out. We have to weigh things. Eto, may malulugi dito ang sinasabi nila. Tama po. I think that there will be a loss in sales, but there will be an increase in tax collections. Now, would the loss in sales translate to the loss of a lot of jobs or to the loss only of a very few jobs that can easily be absorbed by the economy? Now, remember this. They're talking about jobs. The manufacturing sector for cigarettes only employs 7,000 people a year, 7,000. And the tobacco farmers are about 52,000. The tobacco industry has gone from a coverage of about 100,000 hectares in 1971 to 30,000 hectares today. Why? It's not because they were driven out of business. It's because they found better crops and more profitable crops to grow, whatever those crops were. Number two, 50% already of our production is exported. So we will not lose that.
Is this tobacco?
Both tobacco, which is Burley and Virginia,
yes,
and manufactured cigarettes. Exported.
52%?
Yes. I have to trace where it is going to. So the cigarettes, we know where we're going to. We're the biggest suppliers of Marlboro in Thailand. No? This is the manufacturing base for Marlboro, for Philip Morris, for this part of the world. So 50% is exported. So hindi naman mawawala yun because we're not taxing
what
is being exported. No?
Yeah, but Senator, if you're looking into that, isn't that supposed to have been? I'm just asking, sir. Part of the committee report, something like that, taxes that could be collected versus jobs that could possibly be lost. What kind of effect will this have? I mean, hindi ho ba dapat initially naiintindihan niyo na ho yan, or you have a study on that already?
Well, unfortunately, like I said, when everybody was rushing things, I never even took a look at this bill. I said, okay, you guys take care of that. That's what we tend to do in the Senate. Yeah. There's so few of us that we divide the work. May agriculture, may banking, may energy. I wish there were more senators, like 60 to 100, just like in the United States, but we don't have that luxury. So we divided up the jobs among ourselves, and we never I never even paid attention,
so too
much attention
belated.
To it, and until it became a big issue 2 weeks ago, and I said I better have take a look into this and see what's going on. I don't know. There's not that much jobs that will be lost.
Okay. Initially, that's
based
your projection.
Based on what I was running last night.
Okay.
And I was talking to Professor Winnie Monsod, who's now in Washington, D.C., and he was emailing me. And I said, with 7,000 jobs in the manufacturing sector, the most we will lose would be about 500. So let's.
Wow, that's like.
One half is already exportable.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then the drop in sales will be at the lower end, not at the at the Marlboro end. It will be at the Champion end and the Mighty Tea and all that.
Rambo.
Yeah, those things.
Those are the ones that will have
wala
higher.
Wala na sila mapuntan eh.
Normally, sila tataas.
if you're used to buying Marlboro and you're paying 40 pesos and you'll have to pay 60 pesos, those people can afford it, or they can go and buy a
the
cheaper
lower
brand.
Brands,
yeah, which is now 40 pesos.
Ah, all right, okay.
All right. Now, but at the lowest quintile, they call it, this is the tingi-tingi. 70% of our cigarettes are sold tingi-tingi. We open them out and then we sell it one or two sticks at a time.
Yeah.
May credit pa yan, di ba? Sa, what they call it? The sari-sari store? Oh, ah.
Okay.
Aling Maria, next week na lang. Ah,
next
so,
week na yung
nililista niya, no?
Nililista
okay.
Siya.
All right.
Okay.
Wait, so wait.
Sige.
And so they average, the men average about 11 cigarettes.
A day?
A day.
Okay.
And the women, 7 cigarettes a day.
Mm.
So it's, if you're only buying it on that basis, you can bring down your
okay.
average to 8, 7,
bababa
if you're a man.
Lang.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Or else buy a cheaper cigarette.
Very quickly, sir, because we have to go, please answer this question. Now that you brought that up, the plan really in increasing sin taxes is, of course, to discourage people from actually smoking. But with your example, it seems that people will not get discouraged because from a higher price, they can go lower, or from tingi-tingi, they can go, you know, 11 to actually 7 sticks. That takes away that purpose of actually also
No, because the elasticities are different at the different quintile. If you're at the very high end, yes, there's a very inelastic demand for cigarettes. If I have to have my hit of nicotine, then I'm going to find a way to do it,
yeah.
even if I have to smoke lesser or lower brand
yeah,
of
yeah.
cigarettes. But when I'm already at the lowest quintile, in other words, I'm on a tingi-tingi, I'm buying tingi-tingi, many of them are expected to quit, and this has been proven in
okay.
other countries.
All right.
So we hope that we can convince about 3 to 4.5 million people not to smoke or to stop smoking.
Okay. All right, Senator Serge Osmeña, always a pleasure to have you, sir. I learn a lot from each guesting you have here. Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
And
thank you
we'll
for
find out,
me.
Sir, I guess the most important would be the FATF by January. What's going to happen then? The political dynasty, we might as well, I don't know.
You know, your father was there, and he will tell you that was the most traumatic bill we ever passed.
Which one?
The first two, anti-money laundering.
Ah.
Ay, bakbakan kami. 6 months kami sa...
Really, sir?
Sa Baycam.
Yeah. Tagal no, na. Oh, 6 months sa Baycam.
You know that Magsaysay resigned as chairman of
really?
Banks? Because of that,
really,
he was so traumatized.
June? Yeah,
yeah. He almost lugged Angara on the floor.
All right, we're thanking again Senator Serge Osmeña here joining us in Mornings at ANC. There-